I'd like to start the morning's lectureship, please. You've already been welcomed several times, some of you, but if there are newcomers here this morning, we do welcome you to the Payton Lectureship this year, which is being given to us by our colleague George Marsden from Duke University. This morning's lectureship brings us to Edward John Carnell under the title E.J. Carnell and the New Evangelicalism. As I thought myself about Dr. Edward John Carnell, who was a beloved professor of mine during the 50s, and the coinage of minerals and whatnot, gems, I think of him as a diamond, brilliant as a classroom professor. And we thought as thinker and writer, finely cut edges. His articulation, just as a human being speaking to you, the way he thought so crisply, reminded one of a fine cut diamond. There was also a little bit of a steely blue about him. Those who didn't know him well, I think never quite felt that they were right up against Dr. Carnell. There was somewhat of thought of it as a bit of aloofness. I think it was the nature of Dr. Carnell to be a little reticent, a humble man in my estimate. This morning, Dr. Marsden will, as himself a diamond cutter who has been looking at the facets of Fuller's history, help us to look again at this diamond who glittered in our midst once upon a time and who blessed us among us. We welcome you, Dr. Marsden, especially in helping us to see once again a person who once led us and blessed us. Dr. Marsden.
Thank you. This morning, I'm going to attempt to keep what I say slightly briefer than the previous lectures because I'd also like us to have a chance before the panel speaks to hear Carnell speak a bit on his own. And so I brought with me the tape that was made when Carnell came back from the Karl Barth conference in Chicago in 1962, and he reported to the Fuller community on that encounter. And it's a dramatic moment in the history of the seminary, and I think it gives some feeling for the spirit of the times 25 years ago. This year at Duke, I'm teaching a course on American religious biography. And the book I wrote about Fuller Seminary turned out to be a lot like writing a biography. It was a good story. It has very interesting characters, and I was delighted by the narrative potential that there was in the history. One of my graduate students who read the manuscript remarked that it was less analytical than some of the other books that I've written, and it is, and I'm glad for that narrative is in style. I found in my academic work that there are two things one has to say about one's work that can give it credibility these days. One is one should talk about narrative, and the other is one should talk about hermeneutics. And if one simply remarks that all the world is a text and we are interpreting it, we can go on doing what historians have always tried to do, but we can dignify it with the latest intellectual fashion. So there's both narrative and hermeneutics central to this book. But it is, I see understanding the seminary through the story of people. And central to that story is the story of E.J. Carnell. One of the themes that I found to be most interesting and most revealing in the history of the seminary is the theme of breaking away from fundamentalism. And I thought of that as a possible title, breaking away from fundamentalism. I chose reforming fundamentalism because I decided that the intention of the people who were at the changing fundamentalism at the beginning of this institution was not to repudiate fundamentalism, but really to reform it, to make it into what it ought to be, to bring it back to orthodoxy. But that involved necessarily a breaking away from fundamentalism, and that is often a very painful story, that people who break away from their religious roots find themselves cut off socially, personally, cut off from their families. I think in James Barr's book on fundamentalism, he recounts how in his early experience in England, he was very active in inner varsity. That was his religious community. And then the pain of being cut off by that community and vilified by that community when he adopted more liberal views of the Bible. And he, I think, is one of those persons still struggling with that pain. So the theological battles and crises that one deals with are also very poignant personal struggles can be seen and are reflected in many of our own experiences and of experiences we know. And Carnell is a person who embodied those kinds of struggles in a sharper way, I think, and in a more poignant way than most people did. As Charles Fuller once remarked about Carnell in a letter, he said, "He is a sensitive man." And I think that certainly was the case, that he was a very sensitive person. It's remarkable that 20 years after Carnell's death, there are two books coming out this fall in which Carnell figures very prominently. There's this book, and then there's a book by Rudy Nelson that is just being published by Cambridge Press called The Making and the Unmaking of an Evangelical Mind, The Case of Edward Carnell. I've read the Nelson manuscript. He and I corresponded and cooperated to some extent in our research. His book is fascinating. It's insightful. Nelson's a very insightful writer. He's a professor of English. But his book is very different from mine. Nelson basically presents Carnell as a failure, as his title suggests, The Making and the Unmaking of an Evangelical Mind. Nelson himself comes from a fundamentalist background. His wife wrote a very intriguing book on her experience at Moody Bible Institute, Shirley Nelson's novel that I recommend to anyone who has a background of this sort, called The Last Year of the War, and set in 1945, and her attempts to be as religious as fundamentalists ought to be at Moody Bible Institute. But they have moved away from that tradition. He taught at Barrington for a time and was an evangelical, but now he is an ex-evangelical. And much of the analysis in his analysis of Carnell is the viewpoint of Rudy Nelson of a disillusioned evangelical. The book is a very personal book and in a way almost a polemic. It's half biography, intellectual biography of Carnell, and half autobiography of Rudy Nelson. But I recommend it to you. It's very interesting, but I think that Carnell comes off as almost a pathetic figure in it, which causes a difficulty in a biography, that Carnell comes off in Nelson's account as sort of the benighted champion of a rather naively intellectualized Christianity. She tries to get away from the intellectualism, but is rather inept at doing so. By contrast, I see Carnell in my book as playing the role of the tragic hero rather than the pathetic character. I see him as a great character, but a great character who was very deeply and fatally flawed. So with that as my general rubric in mind, let's look at Carnell in a number of his roles. First of all, Carnell as a scholar. As author, I see Carnell as a kind of hero, partly because the task that he took up is one that I admire, that he was trying to restore the intellectual credibility of evangelical Christianity. Carnell had been reared in a Baptist fundamentalist parsonage, and as happened to a number of people who were reared as fundamentalists in the 1930s, when they got into higher education, particularly into graduate work, they became deeply disturbed that their movement was so intellectually mediocre. I have a tape of George Ladd where he says just about the same things that Carnell said on this subject, that when he got to graduate school, he was appalled to find that there was no evangelical author that anybody was taking seriously, except perhaps Machen, and that mainly with a negative kind of seriousness, but there was no evangelical literature that anyone was paying attention to. So here is this cause to which one is committed, but seems to be intellectually mediocre. And that was the challenge to people such as Carnell and Ladd. It's widely known and repeated that Ladd was shattered when Norman Perrin gave him a negative review of Jesus and the Kingdom because he saw his task so much as to establish the credibility of evangelical scholarship in the world of biblical scholarship as a whole. And that was the goal of much of the early Fuller. So Carnell, as others at Fuller Seminary in the early days, set out to defend Christianity against the onslaughts of modern thought, the kind of program that we heard from Carl Henry the other day. That was the job of the generation. And Fuller was to be a center of apologetics. In fact, in the early days, people at Fuller worried that it was getting the reputation of being a center only for apologetics. I ran across a promotional letter that's written in about 1950, and it's one of these kind of breezy kinds of things. It's a sample letter that students were supposed to send to their friends, and it says, "Hey Joe, how are things going? Surf's up. By the way, what are you doing next year? And why don't you come to Fuller?" And you may have heard that Fuller is I'm sort of caricaturing this, but that you may have heard that Fuller is too much of a center of apologetics. But really, it's great in other areas, in biblical studies and in practical studies and so forth. But it had the reputation of everyone was doing apologetics. Whatever the course was, it turned out to be apologetics. And that was the central cause that was being taken up on the scholarly side of this institution, and I think a very important enterprise that was being taken up. Carnell did this very well. He was very successful at it. While he was still in his 20s, he wrote a comprehensive new Christian apologetic. Now, this may have been a quixotic sort of task for someone in his 20s. Certainly, Rudy Nelson thinks so. When I interviewed Bay Lavashady, he was telling about the history of Fuller, and then he said, "Now, who was the man who he was a very young man, and this is in the 40s when Bashley met him, and he had written he was going to write a whole new apologetics starting from scratch. And Vashti, with his European kind of ties, thought that was a rather naive sort of thing to do. It was perhaps, and perhaps typically American, a bit cut off from the past. John Stackhouse, in a MA dissertation on Carnell, describes him as an intellectual Thoreau, and there might be something to be said for that, that he was trying to start again, start from scratch, almost like Descartes, and come up with a convincing apologetic. This trait, however, I think can be interpreted as a sort of tragic flaw. Carnell was a rugged individualist. He was an individualist in principle. If you look at his politics, he was quite individualistic, and he writes things at one point against buying things on credit. One should not buy on credit. There's that kind of a very conservative economic political stance that he had. He was a personality who worked very well on his own, but had difficulty relating to others and working with others. He was, I think, if I may guess without ever having met him, he seemed to be an extreme mix of self-confidence and insecurity. That's a mix that we all have a lot of, and he had it in very extreme forms, and so he had to go it alone. Well, he did this remarkably well. In 1948, still in his 20s, he won the much-heralded William B. Erdman's Evangelical Book Award of $5,000. Now, $5,000 in 1948 was a huge amount of money, and Erdman's hasn't been giving away quite that much since then. But it was a great contribution to promotion of the evangelical apologetical task to set up a book prize with the prize would be equivalent of a good year's salary. Carnell won this and won a great reputation already before the age of 30, and it was sort of the evangelical wunderkind. He continued to produce books through his whole career. During his presidency, he continued to write, and his books had some impact, though they never sold very widely. He had the greatest hopes for Christian Commitment, which he published with a secular publisher, and hoped great things for, but it never sold well. And he had some sense of humor about it. One student reports that Carnell, in a class, said, I great news today, I called my publisher and they sold another of my book. That lack of total recognition hurt, but he was having, part of the problem, I think, was the intellectual Thoreau kind of problem, that because he was starting from scratch, starting again to write an all-new apologetic, that he had difficulty building a community of discourse that would have a following other than among his own students, so that his work has not been, his work as a scholar has not lasted. I doubt if Carnell is much read even at Fuller today. I'm not sure whether any of his books are still in print. He had a considerable impact at the time, but not a great deal since. Nonetheless, he did do a lot to put evangelicalism on the map. And one of the ways that he did that, he became the token evangelical contributor to Christian Century when that was quite a novelty in the late 50s. And he was the person invited to represent evangelicalism when Karl Barth came here in 1962, which we'll hear about in a little bit. Secondly, as teacher. And as Bob Mai said, this is where Carnell shone, whatever, the most brightly. Everyone says this, that he was immensely inspiring as a teacher and a lecturer in the 1950s, that it's a universal report of students, and he was clearly the star on the faculty, and even in the 60s, after his illness, he continued to be, and the student survey shows that he continued to be the most rated, the most influential on the faculty, even into the 60s, when his style of discourse had faded somewhat because of his illness. People reported there would be long, painful pauses, and you can hear this to some extent in the tape. It's not quite as smooth and elegant as the tapes of him in the 50s would be. At any rate, he was a great teacher. Third, as president. And here is one of the stranger episodes, I think, in the history of the seminary, why Carnell became president and how he became president. In 1954, the choice of the president was almost solely in the hands of Harold Ockingay, with the approval of Charles Fuller, but basically it was up to Ockingay. Ockingay had been president in absentia for 7 years. Everyone said, you must come out here to lead the institution. And finally, in 54, they said there has to be a decision. Ockingay was out here staying at the Fullers, and one morning Charles Fuller said to him that he had a great idea that Ockingay could take over the old-fashioned revival hour. Ockingay said, that's the fleece that I've been waiting for, the sign that I ought to come, and announced that he was going to come here. And then later in the summer, Ockingay was persuaded by his congregation that despite this fleece and so forth, he ought to remain in Boston. But what's not well known, and what turns up in some of the correspondence, is that he had already in the spring tapped Carnell to be the backup, that if Ockingay didn't come, he had spoken to Carnell and said, you're it. And one of the great finds that I in the research for this book was in the Ockingay papers, there's extensive correspondence between Carnell and Ockingay. And Mrs. Ockingay was kind enough to open this all up to me, and it's one great source on Carnell. So already Carnell was being chosen. But the question, again, was why would Carnell be chosen, someone who was such an intellectual and not a particularly practical sort of person? Well, I think it's related to Ockingay's sense of looking for the big name, and he saw Carnell as having perhaps the most promise for that. Carl Henry was the other possibility, but I suspect there may have been some tension between Carl Henry and Ockingay already. If you read Carl Henry's autobiography, it is in some respects a polemic about Ockingay, that there was a tension there. Whereas Carnell was indebted to Ockingay, was Ockingay's protege in a way, and Carnell played a rather deferential role when he became president. He sort of played the role of the son to the father role of Ockingay, and also to some extent to Charles Fuller. And in a way, Ockingay and Charles Fuller were still in control of the seminary when Carnell was president. And Carnell plays that role, but he also deeply resents it. And it's typical of his constant ambivalence, that he respects these men and is subordinate to them, but he resents it. What is another factor that's not widely known about Carnell's presidency is that he attempted to resign in 1957. He offered his resignation, and apparently seriously, and that stood for several months before he was persuaded to change his mind. During that time, there was an interview he had with Charles Fuller, and Charles Fuller apparently wrote down notes on it immediately afterward. There's handwritten notes describing this, or looks like the draft of a letter describing this, and he reports how Carnell complained that he wasn't given recognition as president, that there was a trustees meeting and three or four people were asked to speak, but Carnell, the president, wasn't asked, and he sensed, he was very sensitive to that slight. But then when Charles Fuller asked him who else could be president, Carnell threw up his hands and said, "No one, but I am the indispensable man. I have the education, the vision, am qualified except in money raising. I am treated as a little boy." So there's this sense of status that he isn't getting recognition for. Well, he was given assurance that there would be help in money raising, and he turned to money raising. I read this quote the other night. It was often frustrating. He went out with Don Weber in 57. He said he kissed babies, inspected turkey hatcheries, rode around vast ranches, listened to small talk, and sat hours in an unventilated room with children who were in the last stages of Asian flu. But we brought no direct gifts to the seminary. For a seminary, he said, has no direct constituency. The wealthy have no conception of the new evangelicalism. Now, this must have been immensely frustrating to an intellectual. All of us who want to do scholarship and want to write books, to be distracted by a committee meeting can rattle your brains. To be president and have to worry about all the financial responsibilities of an institution and all the distractions of the institution would be something to drive most of us to distraction. Carnell insisted that he wasn't going to concede anything in the area of scholarship. Lars Granberg, who was a friend of Carnell's from the Wheaton days, taught here in the 50s, said that Carnell threw down the gauntlet when he became president and said, I'm going to hold up my end of scholarship and you better hold up yours. And so he continued to do all this and to write books at the same time. And this must have been a very trying kind of experience to do two full-time jobs really at once. Already he was having trouble sleeping. He was on sleeping pills, but by 1959 he simply became desperate to get out. He was hoping that a year of rest would help to restore his tranquility, but the psychological collapse was beginning to develop. It took 2 years, really, before he totally collapsed, and then he had to be hospitalized. The presidency was the occasion of that crisis, though it's hard, one cannot pry into anyone's inner psyche, but certainly that was part of the occasion. The other great occasion of the crisis was the next point, Carnell as new evangelical. All this triumph and tragedy is mixed with the emergence of the new evangelical movement and the split of that movement from the old separatist fundamentalism. A very painful split, particularly in 1957, when Billy Graham decided to go into cooperative evangelism in New York and split from the old fundamentalist leaders such as John R. Rice, and Fuller Seminary was very much in the thick of that kind of struggle. I think one of the keys for understanding that neo-evangelical split from fundamentalism is found and confirmed in Carnell, that Carnell was not a liberal in any sense. He was a defender of orthodoxy. He considered himself not a liberal in any sense, but a defender of orthodoxy. So despite his recognition of problems with the doctrine of inerrancy, for instance, he still continued into the 1960s to defend the concept of inerrancy. He wanted to make the tradition consistently orthodox, to bring it back to its classic Reformation, essentially Reformed heritage. One of the early things that he did early in his presidency with the help of Paul Jewett was to get the premillennial clause removed from the statement of faith, would be removed after Charles Fuller's death, and Charles Fuller eventually assented to that. And the goal was, it's not a liberal kind of move, but rather to make the tradition more consistent with the broad Orthodox Protestant heritage. When he wrote his most controversial book, the book is entitled The Case for Orthodoxy, and I think that it's not the case for evangelicalism or not the case for Reformed theology or whatever, but the case for orthodoxy. And when he criticizes the fundamentalist mentality, particularly as it shows up in J. Gresham Machen, the title of the section is Orthodoxy Gone Cultic. It's the cultic nature of fundamentalist orthodoxy that he wants to get away from and return us to true orthodoxy. And I think that's a large part of the impulse of the what was called neo-evangelicalism. This, however, was a painful process because, as I've said, once one begins to reform a tradition, to break away from a tradition, it cuts you off from friends and family, and you become vilified. And that's not easy when people start writing things that are outrageous about you. You think that this isn't important, but it does grate on you to have someone say something that's terribly unfair. And so Carnell was getting headlines, for instance, in John R. Rice's Sword of the Lord, says, Fuller Seminary's Carnell sneers at fundamentalism. And here's a man trying to be as true to the Bible as he can, and he's vilified as sneering at fundamentalism. And the letters of non-support pour into the old-fashioned revival hour. People, stations are taking this program off the air because of what's going on at Fuller Seminary. There's a lot of pressure on Carnell. And the casebook came out in 59, just at the time of his resignation from the presidency. Achengay writes to him at one point and suggests rather condescendingly, maybe the next time you write a book, you should submit it to your colleagues to check that you don't say anything too outrageous. And people are suggesting, well, maybe his mental instability is responsible for the brash attacks in the case for orthodoxy. So the whole split with fundamentalism is one that is also the occasion for this extreme mental pressure. At the same time, the man is struggling with scholarship and administration, he's struggling with the internalized pain of breaking away from fundamentalism. And perhaps what made this most painful was that one of the things Carnell was acutely aware of in his analysis of fundamentalism was the problem of its bad manners, of its fighting, of its lack of Christian love. And that theme comes up again and again, and I think it's the central motif in Carnell's thought. The central question that he's wrestling with is, how do you balance the love of truth with the love of other people? How do you balance truth and love? That is a central question. That if we stand up for orthodoxy, does that mean we have to cut ourselves off from people and engage in these theological warfares? And he's constantly returning to that theme, which is, I think, obviously a theme within himself. The crisis comes out in his inaugural for the presidency, part of which was read at one of the banquets the other night. Where he calls for Christian love rather than condemning our opponents. And that call brought a delegation of four of the leading faculty who met him backstage and said, "We want to talk to you," and said, "You're talking about Christian love in such a way that you sound just like the modernists." And again, as back in the case in Biola in the 1920s, when someone starts talking about Christian love, people think that's the next step is we're going to get all sorts of modernism. And that hurt Carnell very deeply, that his commitment to truth, he saw, had to be balanced by a commitment to love. And that comes out in his, particularly in his later books. He's constantly trying to deal with that kind of problem, but working in a community where there's nothing like a call for love that will bring a firestorm nothing will bring a firestorm more quickly than a call for Christian love. We can see these two sides of Carnell in the Bart encounter, which we're going to hear his report of. He was very critical of Bart on a number of points, but he's also at other points very reverential of Bart, and he ends up calling for Christian love. Shortly after that, he wrote a piece in the Christian Century criticizing Bart quite sharply, but he ends up saying also, first of all, that he's quite critical of his mentor, Van Til, who said that Bart was more dangerous to Protestantism than Catholicism, and everyone still in 62 was, Carnell at least, was anti-Catholic. He thought that Van Til ought to repent, and he was very hurt by being cut off by his mentors, particularly Gordon Clark and Van Til, who dismissed him because of what they saw as concessive kinds of stances. That was a very deep hurt. After the Bart encounter, Clark wrote a report in Christianity Today, which made Carnell sound soft on inerrancy and wishy-washy and not standing up for the faith. And you'll hear Carnell responding to that. But then in characteristic fashion, he ends up the Christian Century article saying, "Awake from slumber. If you try to upgrade your own estate by downgrading the estate of others, God will see to it that you become a victim of your own cruel standard." And here you can hear him speaking from deep experience. "Scripture is clear. Judge not that ye be not judged. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged, and the measure you give will be the measure that you get." So here you hear the theme that I think is central in understanding Carnell, which is, how do you balance truth and love? Well, let's hear the tape. Those of you who have to leave at the 11 o'clock hour, you can listen to as much of this as you want to, and then you can step out, and then we'll...
Before George puts this on, may I again underline the lunch at 12:30 in Payton, and it is, contrary to worries, available to all who come in Payton 101 A and B.
I should say, this starts in the middle. There's an introduction by Harold Inzel, which would be nice to hear, and then Carnell says a lot of preliminary things about the details of the conference, and I come in the middle of that.
Question. And when I came home from the hospital, I began diligently to work on that procedure, and we were sent a telegram just before we left for Chicago that Dr. Bart didn't like that procedure, and we were to scrap it. The lectures, with the exception of the 2 o'clock convocation on Friday afternoon when Dr. Bart was given a DD degree, were held at 11 o'clock in the morning. And while they were announced in all the journals as an introduction to systematic theology, the series was on an introduction to evangelical theology. I have a few photographs here that I took, both of the Rockefeller Memorial Chapel where the lectures were held and of Carl Barth rushing out after one of the lectures. It happened to have been the Thursday lecture. Perhaps we can see that these are put on the bulletin board for you to see what this gentleman looked like after a lecture. He was led into the chapel on the arm of his son, and I talked with one of the journalists who was there, who said it is a religious experience just to watch the man come into the auditorium. And I think I agree with him. All the lectures were read. Dr. Barth's command of English was excellent for his background, although in relation to one who was brought up in our country, it was not as good as it could have been. His voice was pitched very high, and you had to sit tall to follow the lectures. While on the whole, the lectures and introduction to evangelical theology were very stimulating. I took copious notes. There were disappointments. I was disappointed, in addition to the general vague view of the authority of Scripture, which Barth continued to take for granted all during the series. His language of paradox disturbed me. The questions which I submitted were in four general areas: the metaphysics of the devil, universalism, and the inerrancy of Scripture. And on the metaphysics of the devil, he dismissed it as a possible impossibility, and really thought that he had given a fine, convincing answer. And were I to tell my wife an answer to a question she were to ask me about whether I had fed and clothed the children on the weekend trip she took, yes, honey, it is a possible impossibility. I'm sure she'd look me in the eye and say, make up your mind, yes or no. I'm afraid I need another course in logic, because Barth at that point sounded to me like plain weasel wording. His Christocentric criterion was disturbing to me, when, with a liberty which I don't think the Scriptures allow, he used this as a hermeneutics and was selective in his texts by reason of the compatibility of such texts with his presuppositions in hermeneutics in Christology. So, for example, the Pauline teaching of the federal headship of Adam as well as Christ in Romans 5:12 following, Barth would have, as far as I could detect from the lectures, nothing to do with this kind of a dualism. Then I was disturbed by his oversimplified distrust of natural theology, and in particular the manner in which I thought he was blind to his own use of natural theology. Seems to me that anyone who goes to the portions of the church dogmatics with care will find that Barth has a generous share of arguments which would fall under this classification. Perhaps the most glaring example is found in Volume 3, Section 3, 297 and 9 through 9, where he speaks of Mozart as clear and convincing proof that it is a slander on creation to charge it with a share in chaos, because it includes a yes and no, as though oriented to God on the one side and nothingness on the other. When he presses Mozart into apologetic service, he is not shy to use the word proof. And if this does not fall under natural theology, once again, my terminology needs reconstructing. And I was disturbed by whether Barth reached objectivity in his approach, and as I listened, I didn't feel that as a question directed to the central points which Bart was making that, in fact, he had not succeeded in reaching objectivity, and that the critical portions of his lectures fell under what I would call a theology of feeling. And a word about the panel. The panel was held on Wednesday and Thursday nights of the week at 8 o'clock. Three of the men were on Wednesday night, and three of the men were on Thursday night, and each of us had a half hour with Carl Bart. Our submitted questions formed the background of the discussion, if there was any time left. And it turned out, in my case, that there wasn't any time left, for Bart used 29 minutes in answering my submitted questions. And out of deference to my colleagues, I did not introduce any rebuttal. Dr. Jaroslav Pelikan moderated the panel, and he did, in my judgment, a marvelous job and became a very cherished friend of mine as I made an effort to come to know the man, since I admired him at a distance. We've since had correspondence. Lovely, lovely gentleman. On Thursday night, we had dinner at the Quadrangle Club at the university, and we were supposed to have had Carl Bart with us, but he was too tired to show up, so we went right ahead without him. And this left me at a disadvantage, since on the first evening, the three panelists were selected more for the area of philosophy and epistemology, hermeneutics, the relation between faith and reason, etc., etc. And the second night, the questions were more biblically oriented, and I led off the second night, and the dinner didn't close till 7:45, so there was very little time to collect my thoughts before we appeared before this massive auditorium, where there were people standing all around the sides, and every possible seat was taken, and you had floodlights on you. And if you wonder why possibly I may not have done as excellently at every point as I may have, there were conditions which were not altogether favorable for that kind of excellence, at least in my case. Just a brief summary word about the trip. I spent Saturday and Friday morning at North Park College at the invitation of Cal Catter, our alumnus. I spoke in chapel, led a discussion period with the faculty and with a seminar, and had lunch with the faculty. Monday at Wheaton from 9:30 in the morning until 10:15 at night, graduate chapel, interviews of the faculty, various luncheons with faculty and administrative members and prospective students for Fuller, 4 o'clock Bart class, another luncheon, and then evening discussion. Now that we might have some time for discussion, I will turn at once to a question which has been submitted regarding the report in Christianity Today by Dr. Clark, my former professor at Wheaton College, under whom I majored in philosophy, who I might add has not had a very endeared place in his heart for me ever since the publication of my case book and my reference to J. Gresham Machen. Saint Machen, in Clark's viewpoint, can do no wrong. The question is, you imply, one, that you fail to pursue the question of biblical inerrancy as far as you may have. I grant this. There simply wasn't time. Second, you left Clark with the impression that you do not believe in an infallible scripture, since you have problems with errors in the Word of God. First, I grant that I have problems. If any of you have looked at the case book, the chapter under Perils is devoted to problems. And I envy any of you who are so fortunate as to transcend problems. I draw a very sharp distinction, however, between the admission of difficulties and what I believe as a doctrine. And I want to make it as clear as the English language can put it that I now believe and always have believed plenary inspiration of Scripture and the inerrancy of Scripture I sign the seminary creed with full commitment each year. And anybody in any part of the country is interested in what I believe, I hope you'll be man enough to write and ask me. Now, in the case of the panel, Carl Barth did ask me if I was satisfied with the answers he had given. In fact, when I left on Thursday and went in and said goodbye to him, since the next lecture, well, I guess this was on Friday, he put his arm around me and had re-asked the question. He was so worried, too, about whether he had satisfied the question. I did acknowledge that I was satisfied. But the satisfaction is not with the content of the answer, since in a way, Barth did not really, in effect, answer any of the questions, mine or any of the other panelists, to satisfaction. But I was satisfied with the time and energy he had given to my questions. He gave nearly a half hour answering the questions I had written, and he answered them with sweetness and with charity and with dedication, and he didn't poke fun at me. And two of my questions were specifically on this matter of the inspiration and authority and inerrancy of Scripture. And he didn't say, well, now this is the paper pulp kind of a position, I won't even deal with it. He treated it seriously and fairly. So my satisfaction was at that point. And if Dr. Clark either didn't see it or didn't care to represent it in that fashion, Christianity Today, that is something over which I have no control. Now, who will lead off? Yes.
Yes, sir. What were some of the strong things he said? He gave some of
the Well, only from lack of time, because you can check this out for yourself by reading the Church Dogmatics. Don't suppose that Barth, you know, has reached classical stature on such matters as the Trinity and justification by faith and implications of the gospel on individual and social conduct. He's one of our great leaders at this point. His work in these areas, especially in historical theology, is simply magnificent, and it was magnificent during these lectures. Then I thought his Thursday lecture on the Word of God, while it didn't reach the kind of position that you and I would hold, it came very close to it. And I think it could have been delivered formally, the language to use, at the Moody Bible Institute without offense. It was a magnificent job. And this is why I have no hesitation to say that in my judgment, Barth is an inconsistent evangelical and not an inconsistent liberal. He's a very, very gracious, careful, thorough thinker. Now, if you're interested in the more affirmative details of the Barthian system, you know the source where you can look. We simply don't have time. Now, there was another...
Perhaps
you have answered
most of the questions I was going to ask you. Do you think that his evangelical theology is arbitrarily dogmatic?
Yes, I do.
Do you think that his evasive answers to the questions give any sense of his lacking an intellectual knowledge of the Scriptures?
The second question is a little more difficult. I would probably say that his lack of a knowledge of the Scriptures, such as you and I hope to be leading toward in our three-year discipline here, is from the presuppositions in which the man was trained, especially during his time at the University of Berlin under Harnack and Company. Now remember, he imbibed presuppositions then, which in my judgment, he has not fully conquered, while he has made enormous progress. And the result of these presuppositions is that the man is held back from
taking in Scripture with the kind of abandon that you and I would consider normative for a theologian. So I would say that Bart, who never wearies of calling himself a theologian of the Word, if we heard that once in Chicago, we heard it 50 times, I would say he's a theologian of part of the Word. But I would trace it to presuppositions which may very well be in the area of the unconscious and may go way back to his early training, especially under von Harnack. Well, if you have questions, let's not waste time waiting because we only have a couple of minutes. If you don't have any questions, then I'll give a summary word here and we'll quit. I wouldn't hazard a prophecy at that point because I simply don't know enough about the subtle mysteries of what governs the reason why these mediating schools believe what they do. I think we would be on safe ground to say, however, that this sort of a thing is symptomatic of a trend toward realism today, which ought to give all of us reason for cheer, to think that this took place at the Divinity School at the University of Chicago, which has been traditionally a source of very, very right-wing thinking. But beyond that, I would rather wait for Providence and join you in seeing it. Well, I personally don't know what Karl Barth's view of inspiration is. I couldn't get it out of him in dialogue, and I haven't found it in the dogmatics, since I freely confess I haven't been through them all either. That's, these volumes are long and hard to work through. I felt that Bart spent his time pressing home Jesus Christ, and that the kind of question which I directed toward, the ground on which this dogmatism rests, I think I felt from the tone in his voice that he interpreted it as an intrusion. We should be busy believing, declaring, and living for Jesus Christ. And don't get off on this sidetrack where we argue over syllables, that sort of a thing. Now, what his view of Scripture would be in a carefully worked out section of Prolegomenon, I simply do not know. I'm no expert in Karl Barth. I'll answer one more question, and then I want to say a final word in by way of summary. Well, just let me say this one final word, and I'll turn the chapel back. First of all, remember, Karl Barth achieved the position that he has reached because of discipline. And I would urge upon all of you to learn this lesson of discipline, that wherever you go in life, give yourself to it with all your might. He didn't reach this position by running around the country doing 90-odd jobs, but by staying with one task which he set before him. He set a goal and he disciplined himself. And then secondly, whatever the man lacked in doctrinal consistency, he made up for in personal charm. He was irresistibly gracious. And I personally think he was full of the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. He was a sweet, kindly, loving man. And the power he had on that audience is astonishing. So in all you're getting, I remind you again of the order in which the attribute.
Sorry about the quality of the tape. It was slipping this morning. It doesn't always slip like that. But anyway, you get a pretty good impression. Well, I'll turn it over to you and you introduce.
Will you join me in thanking Dr. Marsden?